Well, hello, Granite Staters. It is great to be in Exeter, and thank you for turning out. What a great crowd. I got to admit, I drove up and I saw the sign that Abraham Lincoln spoke here, and I suddenly felt like, man, I better be good. Oh my gosh, what pressure. But it's really a treat to be here. What a beautiful place. You have a beautiful city, and this is the third time that I've been in New Hampshire since I was put onto the ticket, and that's because New Hampshire is really important. Granite State, you guys are really, really important. Are you going to help us win? All right. That is great. It's been fun, actually, over the years. When I was a DNC chair, I came up and campaigned in New Hampshire a good bit. I was back here in 2014 campaigning with my great friend, Jeanne Shaheen, when she was up. What a fantastic senator you have in Jeanne Shaheen. I've had a lot of fun getting to know your great governor, Maggie Hassan. She's going to make a great United States senator. And I'm really happy to be here with your next governor, Colin Van Oster, and I think he's going to be a remarkable, remarkable governor. His experience in higher education, his ideas about how to create jobs, and also how to tackle tough challenges like abuse disorders. It's really, really important that you put a good guy like him into office, and I'm proud to be sharing a stage with him today. I want to acknowledge Carol Shea Porter. She was going to be here, but then is going to be a little bit late, but you know, we know that she's a great public servant. Please put her into Congress, make sure she's elected. And then I had a chance to visit with somebody I was meeting for the first time, Alexis Simpson, who's running for state senate from right here, thanks to Alexis. And then your state chair, Ray Buckley, was state chair of the party when I was chair of the Democratic Party, and actually all of the chairs elected him to be the chair of the chairs, and I worked really hard with Ray. And so give him a big round of applause and thank him for what he does. Campaigning is tough. We have 54 days left, but it is also delightful because being out with people all across the country, this is the sixth state I've been in 4 days, and we are just working so very hard. Hillary's doing a big rally in Greensboro, North Carolina this morning before doing a couple of important speeches in D.C. And both Hillary and I kind of are the same. We're sort of happy warrior types. We get out, we love campaigning, we love meeting people, we love making our case, but at the same time as we're campaigning full tilt with smiles on our faces, we are also deeply aware that this race is deadly, deadly serious. The stakes are high for our country. The choices are near existential. I point out that most elections are about candidates, and this one certainly is, and I'm going to talk about Hillary and talk about Donald Trump, but in an unusual way, in my experience, this election is also a little bit of a self-definition election. America looks in the mirror, and what is it that we see there? And that's why the stakes are so very high. So what I thought I would do today with you, before just visiting a little bit, is talk about how proud I am to be on this ticket with Hillary, talk about what's at stake, and then talk about how we're going to win here in New Hampshire and how we're going to win all over the country. So let me just start with how proud I am to be on this ticket. I have been in politics for 22 years. Ran my first race to be a city councilman in Richmond in 1994. And I've had a really remarkable career in local, state, and federal office, especially for somebody who didn't even think about politics really at all growing up. I was from a non-political family. When Hillary Clinton called and asked if I would be her running mate, so this is a call from somebody that President Obama described as the most qualified person to be nominated by a major party in the history of the country, and I deeply believe that to be true. Hillary Clinton is so qualified to be a great president and commander-in-chief. Absolutely. And so, when that person says, I want you to be my running mate, I started to say yes right away, and she said, wait a minute, I want to tell you why first. Oh, okay, I guess I was too anxious, you know. So what she said was this, and this tells you about the way she thinks about the job that she is going to do. She said, the test of a Clinton administration will not be a bill signing or the margin by which something passes in Congress. It will be, is a classroom a better place, a better learning environment for a child or a teacher? Is a neighborhood a little bit safer? Can a small business hire a few more employees or a worker get some more skills? The test is going to be, can we make a difference in people's lives? And then she said, look, you've been a missionary, you've been a civil rights lawyer, you've been a mayor, you've been a governor, you've been a senator. I think you can help me make sure that we use the right yardstick to measure our achievements. Are we making a difference in people's lives? That tells you the way she looks at the job. It's about making a difference, which is what she's tried to do her whole life since she was a member of a Methodist youth group in the suburbs of Chicago and kind of got turned on to the big challenges in the world and the responsibility of every person to try to tackle them. So obviously, I'm deeply humbled that that's what the yard, you know, if she wants that yardstick, she thinks that I could be a good partner for her. And the other thing about it that made me so excited to say yes was just reflecting about my own political career. I've been in office for 22 years, and I've always been the one with my name on the bumper sticker or the ballot or the yard sign. And if I'm honest, I have to say my career in politics has been built on the foundation of support by strong women. My wife, Ann, who just stepped down as Secretary of Education in Virginia to campaign full-time for Hillary, she sacrificed a ton to enable me to do what I do. And I've had women campaign managers and cabinet secretaries and agency heads and donors and volunteers. And in this country, in presidential years, everyone since 1964, more women have voted than men. So when Hillary asked if I'd be her vice president, it made me think, you know, for all the strong women who've helped me be a strong man in politics and get a lot done, I'm a strong man who's really excited to play that supporting role for a woman who's going to make history in this country that said in 1776 it was about equality, but then it took us 140 years to even give women the right to vote. But now we're on the verge of making history again and showing our nation and showing the world that when we said equality was our North Star, we mean it. New Hampshire got this before virtually everybody in terms of your track record in electing strong women to major offices. But as a nation, we haven't been what we can be, and I'm so happy that I have the chance to participate and support this magnificent woman and friend to be president. There's a lot at stake in this race, and I want to talk about a couple of issues. But you know what? Before I really get to issues, let's just talk about vision. Let's just talk about the vision that a Clinton-Kaine ticket have and the vision that a Trump-Pence ticket has. And I got a visual aid. So Hillary chose as the theme of the campaign, Stronger Together, and we've just published this about 10 days ago. I think it's number 15 on the New York Times bestseller list, but who's counting? But we just, you know, we just published this long book laying out all the plans, everything that we care about, what we want to do if we have the opportunity to serve. And we put it all under the banner Stronger Together because this is deeply what we believe. If we're going to build an economy, it's got to work for everybody, not just a few. If we're going to be strong in the world, part of that strength is alliances rather than just trying to build walls and tear up alliances, right? So that makes us stronger. That makes us strong. And then, and this is the third pillar of the campaign that's so important, we believe in a community of respect, a community where everybody gets to sit around the table together and any problem or challenge that we have is a problem or challenge we can solve if we let everybody participate and lend their talents to the task of solving these challenges. There's no challenge we have that we're not up to if we just let everybody around the table, but if we divide against one another, if we push some aside or we're afraid of some or blaming others, then suddenly we find that the challenges we have are challenges that we can't solve. We are stronger together when we work together, worship together, learn together. We're stronger together as a country, and that is what this campaign is about, and that is our vision. It's a vision that isn't unique. It's a vision that's been true for a very long time, and we have a fidelity to that vision. Donald Trump has a very different vision. Just like Hillary Clinton publishes this book with our plans, Donald Trump wrote a book when he decided to run for president. He wrote a book about his vision, what he sees. And this is his book, Crippled America. This is the book that he wrote saying why he wanted to run for president. Now, let me just show you this, folks. Right? So the Clinton Kane team is an upbeat and positive, because let me tell you something, not just about Democrats, about Americans. We are upbeat, positive, can-do, optimistic, patriotic, problem-solving people. That's who we are. That's who we are. We don't. That's who we are. That's who we are as a party. That's who Granite Staters are. That's who Virginians are. That's who we are as a nation. We are upbeat and positive. We don't sugarcoat challenges. We embrace them and we solve them. But this is a view that is a view out of the penthouse of the tall tower, right? Looking down and looking at a nation and seeing a crippled America. I do not recognize this picture of our country. I don't. This is not who we are. This is not who we are. And that's why I say it's a little bit of a self-definition election. The nation looks in a mirror and we're saying who we are. I mean, is it a stronger together nation or is it a crippled America? Couple of issues. I just did a really fun event down the seacoast in Portsmouth where we sat in a coffee shop with a lot of millennials and talked about issues of importance to millennials, especially kind of around business and education, how to be a startup culture. And I just want to talk about two of the issues that we talked about there and just contrast a little bit between what a Clinton presidency would mean and what a Trump presidency would mean. And the issues are education and also how do you make life work, like life, family, work balance work? You know, these kind of important issues, like in this case, I want to talk about family leave. Education. Hillary and I really believe that education is the foundation for this whole thing. So if you invest in expanding early childhood education, if at the K-12 level you celebrate great teachers, not running them down, but celebrating them and trying to attract them and retain them, then you're going to be much stronger. And we particularly are focusing on one of the biggest education challenges of the day, which is the affordability of college. This is something that you know well here in New Hampshire, because all over the country now, student loan debt is bigger than credit card debt. But here in New Hampshire, 3 out of every 4 students who graduate from college end up in debt, and the average amount is $33,000, which is one of the highest in the country. And the total student loan debt in New Hampshire now exceeds $4 billion. Now, in Virginia, it wouldn't be all that different. This is a nationwide problem. But you know the challenges that it creates. It puts on the shoulders of parents and grandparents, how are we going to pay for college? And then children get out of school with debts, how are they going to do it? And if a student has big loan debts, it affects what jobs they can take. It affects where they can live. It delays them purchasing things like cars that help drive the economy. It delays them by years maybe in buying a house, which helps drive the economy. So the cost of college and student loan debt has a huge effect, not just on individuals and their futures, but a huge effect on the economy. Hillary and I have a plan that we've put on the table. We just rolled this out on the webpage the other day called College Calculator. You can go to hillaryclinton.com, College Calculator, to figure how it would affect you. And it's affecting not only students, but their parents and grandparents and others who are helping them. And the basic plan is this. We should be able to make a guarantee as a nation that you can go to college debt-free. Other nations do it that have a weaker economy, lower income than the United States, because they make it a priority. We ought to make that a priority, too. College, community college, career and technical training. We can make that debt-free. We can make it debt-free. And we have a second step that says, look, for families that make under $125,000, we also should make college tuition free at the in-state tuition level. And we're going to work on both of those. This is a huge jump forward. Probably educationally it would be equivalent of something like the GI Bill after World War II, which rocketed us ahead economically because we started to do so much better than the rest of the world in providing education. But it's time that we do that again, lift the burden of debt off students' shoulders, lift it off families' shoulders, and enable our young people to get the kind of skills they need to be successful. And while we're on that topic, skills doesn't just mean college and community college. It also means apprenticeships and career and technical training. I know we got a lot of folks from labor here. I grew up in an iron worker household. We've got to value trades and technical training because that's a career path that should be every bit as promoted and accepted and celebrated and encouraged as getting a college degree, and we've kind of sometimes let that go a little bit in our society. So that's what Hillary and I are going to do on the college side. Now, it's a little hard to compare this with Donald Trump because he hasn't yet really put out a higher ed plan. He might. It's not been important enough. It hasn't been a high priority issue for him, even though it's a high priority issue for families. But what we do know about Donald Trump is Trump University, right? So how did he think about higher education? The way we're thinking about it is, it's really important. We want to broaden access to it and make it more affordable. How's Donald Trump thinking about higher education? Well, wow, it's a money-making opportunity for me. So I can start this school that's not accredited, and I can work really hard to try to get people to give me a lot of money and give them something that's really worth nothing in return. And some of the stories are really heartbreaking. Tens of thousands of dollars given to him by people who are veterans using GI Bill or Veterans Bill benefits. In some cases, the GI Bill that transferred to a surviving spouse after a military member was killed on deployment. The spouse trying to use these monies to create some economic security, and they end up giving these monies to Trump University, not knowing that the university curriculum wasn't really worth anything, and that the university employees were being schooled on, here's how to get more money from these people. Tell them to max out their credit card if they can't pay you a check. And so all these people ended up really being in a tough jam, and now Trump University is being sued all over the country. I think for a president, we should have somebody who understands the importance of education in raising people's success and in growing the economy, not who looks at education as here's a money-making thing where I can get money out of people's pockets and not give them anything. Seems to me that the choice, if you worry about education and college, between a Hillary Clinton and a Donald Trump is very, very clear. Very, very clear. But I would, if you're interested in this, if you're interested in it, I would encourage you to go hillaryclinton.com, look at College Calculator, and you can figure it out. A second issue that I just want to talk about on the policy side, because we were talking about it in Portsmouth, a number of our millennial panelists were saying, boy, you know, I'm pursuing opening a business, I'm working in another business, growing my career, and that we have a challenge with respect to family leave. I had a panelist who had a three-month-old baby, and she was talking about the challenges of her wife having to take unpaid family leave when the baby was born, and how that put an economic challenge on them. Now, we're kind of used to this because it's the way we've run it, but other nations don't do it that way. Other nations offer paid family leave to either care for a child right after birth, but also to do something that virtually everybody in this room, I'm sure, has done at one time or another, which is to try to care for a sick family member. And so Hillary has a plan that she's pushed for a long time, 12 weeks of paid family leave, where if you are taking care of a child or taking care of a parent with Alzheimer's, for example, you can get up to 12 weeks of paid family leave, and you would be guaranteed to be paid two-thirds of your income during that 12-week period. Again, a very, very important recognition of the fact that here's the way the world works today, here's the way the workplace works. And if you make it easier for people to do that, what you find is actually end up with more productive employees. They're happier, they feel more sense of stability and security, and then it ends up being better for everybody. Donald Trump this week put out his response, and his response was not family leave, it was maternity leave. See, it's just the women's issue to deal with. It's not to take care of a sick relative, it's just after childbirth, and it's just for women to deal with. Men don't have to worry about it. You know, studies have shown this, that if you require maternity leave and not paid family leave, an employer will think, man, I may have to give that woman maternity leave. And then they become a little bit more reluctant to hire women rather than men. But if it's an equal benefit, everybody gets family leave, then there's no incentive to just hire men, not women, and you can treat people fairly. Again, equal is equal. You can treat people equally. And the other thing about Donald Trump's plan that's interesting is while the Clinton plan is paid family leave that is an employee benefit, Donald does it by not an employee benefit. We will let a woman take 6 weeks of maternity leave and collect unemployment insurance. It takes money out of the unemployment insurance programs, which could then benefit, it could hurt the benefits that unemployed workers need by having them all compete for the same funds. But it also, I don't know, it's just kind of an oddly kind of stigmatizing thing in a way to say, no, this is an unemployment insurance benefit. It's not a paid family leave program. And because unemployment benefits are often just at a real discount over wages, you're not going to get paid two-thirds of your wages during the paid family leave. It'll be a lot less. So again, a very different philosophy that isn't a philosophy of equality, that isn't a philosophy of, hey, this is a good thing to do that'll make you more productive. And it's kind of what Donald Trump has often said is hiring women when they get pregnant is such an inconvenience. It's kind of a strategy that even suggests that this is kind of an inconvenience. And that's just not the way Hillary and I are going to do things. So these are two important issues to families, to students, to our economy, to New Hampshire, to Virginia, to our nation. Tell you, there's one other thing that's come up this week that I want to dig into a little bit, and then I'm going to get to my third issue, which is how to win, how we have to win this race, and where you come in and why New Hampshire is so important. And the third issue is this. I don't know if any of you saw this, but yesterday Newsweek ran a story about Donald Trump's business dealings. Donald Trump had said in a number of the Republican debates that I have about 120 foreign business deals going on right now. And he was saying this to show, see, I can be a president that will deal with foreign relations issues. People started asking then right away, well, show us what those business deals are, because that might be important for us to know, and he has not done it. But yesterday, Newsweek put together what they could find, and what they found was pretty discouraging. Donald Trump has, through his family companies, have business deals all across the world, including with countries that are very adverse to the United States or individuals in those countries, some even with criminal backgrounds and criminal records, and the information hasn't been disclosed. I mean, as an example, he's got deals in the India-Pakistan part of the world where the deal working out puts a lot of money into his pocket, but it could affect his view of what we should do to try to promote stability in that part of the world and stable relations between India and Pakistan. Similarly, it's come out that he and his organization owe money to the Bank of China. He says he's going to hold China accountable, but China basically has him in hock to them, and so there's a real question of how he could hold them accountable. I think you've all followed the bizarre fascination that Donald Trump has with Vladimir Putin. And he has a lot of business deals in Russia with some with sort of the government or individuals connected with the government, similarly in Ukraine with pro-Russian elements of the Ukraine. And these are deals that are putting a lot of money into his pocket, helping him out, helping his family out. They're really important to him. That may explain why he always says positive things about Putin. Putin is a great leader. He said Putin was a better leader than President Obama. Mike Pence, his running mate, my opponent for vice president, said, it is inarguable that Vladimir Putin is a better leader for his country than Barack Obama is for America. I mean, just think about that. I when I heard that, my heart sunk, because what I thought of is, running your economy into the ground, that's leadership? Persecuting journalists, that's leadership? Persecuting LGBT Russians, that's leadership? Invading other countries and violating international law, that's leadership. Committing cyber espionage against your own country, Donald, you call that leadership? See, because to my way of thinking, if you can't tell the difference between dictatorship and leadership, then you have no business being president of the United States. No business. In fact, is there anybody who would pass a fifth grader on a civics exam if they couldn't tell the difference between leadership and dictatorship? No. And yet, this is the person who wants to be our commander-in-chief, who wants to be our president. And so this Newsweek story really lays it out. I would encourage you to read it, and it raises a couple of questions. So first, in the foreign policy arena, when we have all these challenges around the world and people look at us as a leading nation. I have a child deployed overseas in the Marines right now. This matters a great deal to me personally. Matters a great deal to me personally. Do you want a president making decisions about our foreign policy and what is an American interest who has got financial interests all over the globe that he's not disclosed, who might be thinking, well, I could do this, but it might hurt the stake of my investment in Russia, might hurt the stake of my investment in Kazakhstan or wherever the investments are. I mean, that's a huge, huge problem for a president to have those kind of conflicts. And I'll tell you what a second problem is. I've often heard preached in my parish the lesson out of Matthew, no man can serve two masters. No one can serve two masters. So just on the domestic level, just set aside all the foreign policy challenges. I want a president that's thinking about New Hampshire's bottom line, not his own bottom line. I want a president that's thinking about America's bottom line, not his own bottom line. And if you are even taking 5 or 10% of your energy and you're thinking about your family businesses and what's happening and whether it's going to affect them, then you're taking your energy away from the pressing challenges that we have in this country and the problems that we need to solve. No one can serve two masters. And that's why Donald Trump needs to come clean and reveal the information about these deals so that the American voters who have a right to know can make their own decisions about whether he has conflicts of interest and whether he's qualified to be president. It's so important. And while we're on the subject of disclosure, Hillary Clinton has released her tax returns going back to 1977 for two reasons. One, because it's the precedent. This is what people do when they get into the job interview to be president of the United States. This is what every president has done going back. Even President Nixon released his tax returns. I mean, if you can't come up to the standard of President Nixon, the ethical standard, you got a problem. And so Hillary Clinton has done this because this is what you do when you're running for president. But she's done it for another reason. She believes American voters have a right to know, has she been responsibly paying her taxes? Has she been giving to charity? Does she have any interests or loans to anybody that would make folks question her judgment? Whether you are a Democrat, Republican, or independent, Hillary believes you have a right to know that information. Donald Trump hasn't only, obviously, not released this information about his deals. He hasn't released his tax returns. When in 2014, he promised, if I run for president, I will release my tax returns. He urged Mitt Romney and others to release their tax returns. But now that he's running, he is suddenly saying, the rules that apply to everybody else don't apply to me. I'm trying to hide what's in my tax returns. And you know what? He thinks that voters might let him get away with it. Are we going to let him get away with it? Absolutely not. We can't. Because if we let him get away with it, then everybody will try to get away with it. I don't know what's in Donald Trump's tax returns, but I have some suspicions. I mean, for example, as part of casino applications, a couple of times he had to give tax returns in the 80s and 90s, and they showed that in those years, he paid nothing in federal taxes. So I'm not going to ask, raise your hand if you love paying taxes, because I'm not going to get one hand up. But I do think many of us understand that there is a responsibility and a price of living in community. If you support teachers, you understand that taxes are what pay teachers' salaries. If you support veterans, you understand it's taxes that fund the VA. If you support the military, then you understand that it's taxes that fund the military. Donald Trump has bragged throughout his life, I do everything I can to pay as few taxes as possible. You can't publicly brag about paying as few taxes as possible and then jump into a race for president and say, I'm going to be great for the vets. If you've been stiffing vets your whole life, don't tell me now you're going to be great for the vets. Don't tell me that now. You can't do everything you can to avoid paying taxes your whole life and then jump into a presidential race and say, man, I'm going to be great for the military. Because if you've been avoiding taxes, you've been stiffing the military your whole life, not supporting them. And there's no evidence that you could suddenly say, I'm going to be a great commander-in-chief. Again, I think military families understand this. And then on health records, Hillary and I have now put out voluminous health records about ourselves. I had a lot of people asking me today about my inactive case of plantar fasciitis, which my doctor's letter concluded with, and I advise you that you should start taking a daily vitamin D supplement. And so a lot of people have been asking me, are you taking your vitamin D today? But we put out a lot of information about our health, and I didn't have a chance to watch this Dr. Oz thing this morning. But instead of putting out kind of legit information about his health like other candidates do, Donald Trump is just kind of holding back. And again, I just want to say one more thing on this before I get into how do we win. If I was coming to you and I wanted you to hire me for a summer job, say I'm a teenager, and you asked me a question like, have you ever had a job before? I'm not telling you. Will you give me any references? Nope, not giving it to you. I mean, would you hire me for a summer job? No, of course you wouldn't. You couldn't get hired for any job in this country if you refused to provide the basic information and answer the basic questions that go along with that job. You wouldn't get hired anywhere. But what Donald Trump is trying to do is avoid answering the basic questions that are part of this job interview. And the thing that is maddening about it is he actually thinks that American voters will let him get away with it. It's so disrespectful of the voters to think I can blow this thing by him and not answer any of their questions. That's why the stakes of this race are so high. And that's why we have to win. And let me now talk about that. How do we win? The race is close. We were absolutely dead heat coming into the first convention in Cleveland. Coming out of the convention in Philadelphia, we actually really got a bump. And you often do that out of a convention. We got a good bump. But then over the last few weeks, it settled back down. We are still ahead in virtually all of the really contested states where we need to be ahead, but not all of them. And in a number of the states where we're ahead, we're not ahead by a lot. We're ahead just by a little margin. And so that means nothing to take for granted. I would rather be us right now than them. I think we have a more straightforward path to win, and they have a more complicated path. But boy, nothing to take for granted. Nothing to take for granted. Because, look, let's be honest, it's been a season of surprises, and so some polls have been wrong, and some pundits have been wrong, and so you can't take anything for granted. And Citizens United got decided where you can just dump hundreds of millions of dollars on TV, run negative ads, and say anything about anybody, and nothing can be done. So that can affect a race, nothing to take for granted. And Hillary Clinton's trying to do something that nobody's ever done before, be the first woman president of the United States, nothing to take for granted, nothing to take for granted. I think we all know, if that were easy, it would have been done. So it hadn't been done, so it's not easy. And I bet, as I look around, I bet some of you have tried to do something in your own life that hasn't been done before. Maybe the first in your family to try to do something, or maybe you've been in a situation and you've tried to do something and you had people telling you, I don't think that's going to work out, or I don't think you can do it. Sometimes that's an enemy telling you that, and sometimes it's even a friend. I don't want you to be disappointed. I don't think this is going to work out for you. I think it's going to be too hard. Can I tell you that Hillary Clinton's been hearing that her entire life in one way or the other from people, that this probably isn't going to work out for you. It's probably going to be too hard. You know, you need to smile more. You're not likable enough. You don't look presidential, as Donald Trump said about her a few days ago. So we have to assume this thing is really, really hard. Doing important things is hard. Making history is hard. This is going to be hard. But I don't mind hard. Do you guys mind hard? No, I think we specialize in hard. We specialize in hard. We really do. I will tell you a little secret about me. I have run 8 races, and I have won 8 races, and I'm not going to lose this one. I'm not going to lose this one. Not going to. And I'll tell you, when Hillary asked me to be on the ticket, she told me those things about, you know, it's about making sure that we serve in the right way and it makes a difference in people's lives. But when she talks about me on the trail, she always adds, and he's never lost a race. I'm kind of like a good luck charm, I think. Never lost a race. But I'll be honest with you, now that I've kind of puffed myself up, I do have to be honest, I barely win my races. I'm not a big landslide guy, no. No, I barely win my races. And I always say to young people, career advice, if you find that you're a barely likable enough person, go into politics. You just need 51%. There's no other profession where 51% is success. But hey, in politics, you know, it'd be success. But to be serious for a minute, the reason I barely win a lot of races is because Virginia's tough. I mean, it was super red when I started, and it's gone a little bit better now, but it's not an easy state. It's not an easy state at all. But the way that I win is an attitude, and Hillary has this attitude too, and the attitude is, I'm the underdog until I'm the winner. I'm the underdog until I'm the winner. I don't care what a poll says. I don't care what an editorial says. I don't care if somebody sees me on the street and says, I think it's looking great. I'm the underdog until I'm the winner. And I think that that's an attitude that we all get. One thing that the Democrats are kind of a big, happy family, and we're kind of all different types, but we're underdog people, folks. We are underdog people. We have an instinctive sympathy and want to battle for the underdog. Again, just thinking about my own experience, we kind of call them in my church Good Samaritan people. You know, if somebody's having trouble on the side of the road, some will pass by, but we're not the kind of people to pass by. We're the kind of people, even if we don't necessarily know all the answers, that are willing to kind of roll up our sleeves and try to get in, try to help somebody out. And so we're underdog people. And that means the way we're going to win this thing in 54 days here in New Hampshire is just have that underdog mentality. And this is where you fit in. Raise your hand if you have already volunteered to work on this campaign. Give them a round of applause. That's really great. That's really great. So what I would encourage you to do, if any of you have not yet volunteered, please do. All you have to do is text TOGETHER to 47246 or reach out to anybody that had their hands raised and say, how do I do it? HillaryClinton.com online, you can do it that way too and volunteer. Because you know this in New Hampshire probably better than anybody, the person-to-person still matters. The TV ads, people are turning them out. They're just too many of them, and they're too negative, and we don't know who's running them, and we don't know if they're true. So people tune them out. They tune them out. But they still will believe a word from someone they trust, because people are deeply interested in their country and in the race and the choice they should make, and they believe a word from somebody they trust, a friend, a coworker, somebody they're in school with, a parishioner, a neighbor. They believe a word from somebody they trust. And here's a funny thing that I've found in 22 years in elected office, they'll even trust a word from somebody they don't know. If you call someone or knock on the door and say, I'm a volunteer working for Hillary Clinton, the first thing they hear, volunteer. They didn't have to do this. They're taking their time as a volunteer to do this because they think it's important enough. That opens up the door to have a discussion, to talk about issues that matter, answer some questions, talk about the importance of voting. Talk about all the issues. Do we believe in climate science or not? Do we want to preserve and defend and promote and expand Medicare and Social Security or privatize it or voucherize it? There's a whole series of issues that you can get into with people, but they will believe you. And so if you could join in to this volunteer effort in the last 54 days, see the stakes as large stakes, be energized by this vision that's a stronger together vision, not a crippled America vision. If you can do that, then I'll tell you this. I know, because I've watched you, I know what work you can do here. I've watched elections up here. I know what you can do. And if we tackle it with that underdog spirit in the next 54 days, then we're going to make history for this country and around the world on November 8th. And then the real work of making history will start as we build an economy that works for everybody, as we exercise American leadership in a world that still desperately needs it, leadership to keep us safe, And as we keep plowing forward, building a community of respect, not a community of division, not a community of fear, not a community of blaming anybody. You ready to do that, Granite Staters? I think we can do it. With your help, I know we'll do it. Thank you so much for having me here to Exeter. Let's go win this thing. Appreciate it.
Senator.